In this class, let us consider Fourier's theorem. This is the statement of the theorem. Any finite single valued periodic function can be expressed as a summation of simple harmonic terms whose frequencies are integral multiples of the frequency of the given function. Such a series is called Fourier series. So this theorem is named after Fourier. He was a mathematician as well as a physicist. So this theorem is the idea of this theorem is consider a finite, okay, which means that its values at any point are finite. Single valued means at any given point the function has only one value. There are no multiple values corresponding to a single variable, single point. Suppose you have a function of x, then at a given x, the function y of x has only a single value. Okay, it doesn't have multiple values. And it's a periodic function with some period capital T, or let us say the frequency is omega, angular frequency of the function is omega, where omega is 2 pi by T. So you have a finite function, single valued function, and it's periodic. Then it can be expressed as a summation of simple harmonic terms, that means sine functions and cosine functions, whose frequencies are integral multiples of the frequency of the given function. So this periodic function can be expressed as a summation of sine functions and cosine functions. So such a series of terms is called Fourier series. So in mathematical terms, we can express this statement like this. Suppose you have a function f of t. And the frequency of the function or the period of the function is capital T, or the frequency is omega, which is 2 pi by T. Then this function can be expressed as a series like this. Some constant A0 plus sum over n from 1 to infinity An sine n omega T plus sum over n from 1 to infinity bn cos n omega t. So this is an infinite series. There are infinite number of terms in this series, but these terms will be converging, okay, to the function f of t. Okay, so we have this function f of t. It is expressed as a series of terms. There is a constant here A0, and there are other constants here An and then Bn. This constant A0, An, Bn are called Fourier coefficients. Okay, so there are in the second summation stands for infinite number of terms like A1 sine omega t plus A2 sine 2 omega t. We can see that in each harmonic term, sine function as well as in cosine function, the frequency of these harmonic terms are integral multiple of the frequency of the given function. Okay, sine omega t, sine 2 omega t, sine 3 omega t, etc. Similarly, cos omega t, cos 2 omega t, cos 3 omega t, etc. Okay, so now we want to evaluate these constants A0, An and Bn. Okay, so let us find each of them. So first we want to calculate A0. So how do you calculate A0? For this, let us multiply both sides of the this equation, the series, with a small interval of time dt, and integrate from 0 to capital T, where capital T is the period of the function. Okay, the relationship between period and angular frequency is omega is equal to okay, omega is equal to 2 pi by t. Okay, So we integrate both sides from 0 to capital T. So each term we have to integrate. Then in the first term, a0 is a constant that we can take out. So the remaining terms integral 0 to t dt. In the second terms, the summation over n from 1 to infinity, an, this we can take out. So the time dependent function is sine n omega t dt. Okay. Then the third term, the third set of terms, right? So we can take this again summation outside, bn integral 0 to t cos n omega t dt. Okay. Now let us evaluate each of these terms. The first term is a0 into, when you integrate this, we get small t. When you put the value limits, you get capital T, and the other limit will be will give the value 0. And here, sum over n from 1 to infinity an. Okay, what is the integral of sine n omega t? It is minus cos n omega t, right? So minus cos n omega t divided by the coefficient of time will be in the denominator, and you have to put the limit 0 to capital T. Okay, then the next term, sum over n from 1 to infinity bn integral of cos n omega t is sine n omega t divided by n omega within the limits 0 t. Okay. Now, okay, so the first term is just like that, a0 into t plus in the second term, okay, we can take this minus outside, n omega also outside. When you put the upper limit, we get n omega capital T. But look at the relation between omega into t. When you multiply omega with the t, we get 2 pi. Okay. So when you put the upper limit here in this term, when you put the upper limit, you get n omega capital T. That is n into 2 pi. Cos 2 pi n is 1. Okay. So upper limit you get 1, and when you put the lower limit, small t equal to 0, cos 0 is also 1. So 1 minus 1 will be 0. Okay. So this term will be 0. So this second term is 0. What about the third term? In the third term, you have sine n omega t. When you put the upper limit, you have n omega capital T. Omega into capital T is 2 pi, sine 2n pi. Sine 2n pi is 0. Lower limit small t equal to 0, sine 0 is also 0. So both terms are 0. So this term also will yield 0. Okay, so the right hand side there is only one term, a0 into t. So our aim is to calculate a0. So the expression for a0 is a0 equals 1 by t 0 to t f of t dt. Okay, that's the value of a0. In other words, it is the average value of the given function. Okay. Okay. Next, let us calculate the constant an. Okay. This an, n is a dummy variable. In this second term, there are a large number of terms here. A1, A2, A1 sine omega t, A2 sine 2 omega t, okay, etc. There are a large number of terms are there. So we want to find out any one term in this set, okay, any one coefficient of the sine terms. So let us consider it as rth coefficient. Okay, so the next step is to find AR, where R is one of the values of n between 1 and infinity. See, in this summation, n varies from 1 to infinity. So one value, let us, one of these values is n equal to r. Okay, so let us find out that. And for this, let us rewrite this summation like this: a0 plus summation n not equal to r. Okay, an sine n omega t plus. Okay, so in this summation, I have taken n all the terms with n not equal to r, and the remaining term is for n equal to r. When n equal to r, we have ar sine, instead of n, we have r omega t. Okay, so these two together form the single term in the earlier expression. Okay, this is summation over n from 1 to infinity an sine n omega t. Okay, so we have considered all the terms which are from this summation. We have considered all the terms which are not for which n is not equal to r, and the single term for which n is equal to r. Our aim is to find out this coefficient ar, because this is applicable for any term in the series. Okay, the third term will be given just like that. That is sum over n from 1 to infinity bn cos n omega t, right? Okay. So here in this term, there can be n equal to r term, n not equal to r term, that doesn't matter. Okay. So we will see what it means. So then, in order to find out this ar, what I am going to do is see the term along with ar is sine r omega t, right? So I am going to multiply both sides with sine r omega t, okay, and then integrate from 0 to t. So we have on the left hand side f of t sine r omega t dt. I am going to multiply all the terms with sine r omega t dt and then integrate from 0 to capital T, where capital T is the time period. So the first term is a0, I have taken outside the integral. The remaining terms are sine r omega t dt plus, okay, in the summation. So in the second term on the right hand side, there is a summation, summation over n not equal to r. An also we can take outside, and the integral is sine n omega t, which is already there. In addition, we are multiplying with sine r omega t dt. Okay, that's the integral. Then there is ar term. So we have ar taken outside, integral 0 to t. Already sine r omega t is there. See here, sine r omega t is there. In addition, we are multiplying with another sine r omega t. So the two together will be sine square r omega t dt. Okay, remember, we are multiplying each term with sine r omega t dt. And the last term, cosine terms, sum over n from 1 to infinity bn integral 0 to t. Already this cosine term is there, cos n omega t term is there. In addition, we are multiplying with the sine r omega t dt. Okay, so there are four terms on the right side. Okay, let us evaluate each of them. First of all, this term is 0. This we have already established in the previous calculation. See, we have shown that integral 0 to t sine n omega t dt is 0. N is an integer. So, by the same logic, integral 0 to t sine r omega t dt is 0. So, that term goes. Then, okay, we have to consider this integral. Sine n omega t sine r omega t dt, this integral. Okay. So this part Okay, so this part is like sine A sine B. Okay, sine A sine B. So when we have such a term sine A sine B, then yeah, what we can do is both are time dependent terms. So what we can do is we can convert this into sin A sin B. If it is there, then this can be expressed as a combination of cos A plus B and cos A minus B, right? Yeah, so then we have to, you will have to rewrite this as a combination of cos A plus B. Cos A plus B is cos A cos B minus sin A sin B. Then cos A minus B is cos A cos B plus sin A sin B. Then take cos A minus B minus cos A plus B, then we get 2 sin A sin B. Okay, so you can substitute that here. Yeah, let us do that. Then okay, so the summation over n not equal to our an is already there. So what you have is integral 0 to t. So this is sin A sin B. We can write as cos A minus B minus cos A plus B, right? So we have cos A minus B, we can write as n minus r omega t. Okay, cos A minus B minus cos A plus B. A plus B is n plus r omega t dt. Okay, cos A minus B will be as I have considered earlier, cos A cos B minus sin A sin B, and the other thing is cos A plus B will be cos A cos B. No, cos A minus B is cos A cos B plus sin A sin B, and cos A plus B will be cos A cos B minus sin A sin B. So when you take the difference, cos A cos B term will go, you will have 2 sin A sin B, and we can put a 1 by 2 also here, so the 2 will cancel. Now here, how do you evaluate this? Remember that in this summation, n is not equal to r. So this n and r are different. Then what you can do is both are integers. N is an integer, r is an integer. This n minus r, okay, we can consider as an integer, let us say some p. N plus r is also an integer, let us say some q. So this is like cos p omega t and cos q omega t integrated over one period. And in the previous calculation of a0, we have shown that integral 0 to t cos n omega t dt is 0, where n is an integer. By the same logic, this integral 0 to t cos p omega t and integral 0 to t this cos q omega t will be 0. Okay, so this term will be 0, this term will be 0, and this term also will be 0. Okay, so there goes this entire term. For n not equal to r term, okay, that this entire term is 0, so there is no contribution there. Then let us consider this term, ar integral 0 to t sin square r omega t. So how do you evaluate this? Integral 0 to t sin square theta usually be evaluated as, by rewriting this as 1 minus cos 2 theta by 2. That is 1 minus 2r omega t divided by 2, and the 2 I can take out. Okay, then we have two integrals here. This will be, you can write this as 1 by 2 into the first integral. The first integral will give integral 0 to t dt, which is t. And the second integral will be 0 to t cos 2r omega t. Cos 2r, r is an integer, so 2r is also an integer. And this integral 0 to t cos n omega t dt is 0. So this term will be 0. So we have a contribution t by 2. So the term is, ar is also here. So that term, a third term will be ar into t by 2. And what about the last term? Okay, in the last term we have an integral here. N can be equal to r or n need not be equal to r. So whether it is equal to r or not, if it is not equal to r, n not equal to r, we can consider two options. Suppose n is not equal to r. If n is not equal to r, this term we can rewrite. This is something like cos a sin b. Okay, cos a sin b. So cos a sin b comes in the expansion of sin a plus b and sin a minus b. Sin a plus b is sin a cos b minus cos a sin b, and sin a minus b is sin a plus b is sin a cos b plus cos a sin b. Sin a minus b is sin a cos b minus cos a sin b. So in order to get this cos a sin b, what we have to do is take sin a plus b minus sin a minus b. Okay, then we get 2 cos a sin b. You can divide with 2. This term you can rewrite as sin a plus b minus sin a minus b. And this a plus b will be n plus r. It contains n plus r. A minus b will contain n minus r. So for n not equal to r, you can put this n plus r equal to some p, n minus r equal to q. Then you can show it, the integral will be like integral 0 to t sin p t and sin q t. And both terms are 0. So this entire term will be 0 for n not equal to r. Okay, when n is equal to r, how do you write this? When n is equal to r, you can write this as, this is like sin cos n omega t sin n omega t. Okay, so this is half of sin 2 n omega t. Integral of 0 to t sin 2 n omega t is also 0, because 2 n is also an integer and that is 0. So my point is, for n not equal to r, you can integrate this using one technique. When n equal to r, you can integrate using another technique. In both case, this will be 0. Okay, you can verify that. So among the four terms on the right hand side, only one term contributes. Okay, a 0 term is 0, a n term or n not equal to r, that is 0. Only this a r term will have some contribution. And what is that term? A r times t by 2. Okay, so what is the value of a r then? Let us see what we have on the left hand side. On the left hand side we have this term, integral 0 to t f t sin r omega t dt. On the right hand side we have ar times t by 2. So ar is equal to 2 by t integral 0 to t f of t sin r omega t dt. Okay, so by changing r you can calculate any value of ar. You can calculate a1, a2, a3, etc. This is the formula. So 2 by t integral 0 to t f of t sin r omega t. Okay. Now similarly we can find out a generic coefficient br. And for that I am not doing all the algebra now. How do you calculate ar? What we have done is we have expanded this Fourier series in such a way that this a terms is re-expressed as n not equal to r term and n equal to r term, right? And similarly to find br, what we can do is we can expand this series like this. In bn we can write it as n not equal to r term and n equal to r term. So for n equal to r term we have br cos r omega t. Okay, so to find the value of br, what we have to do is multiply both sides with cos r omega t dt and integrate. Okay, and finally, the value of BR that you are going to get is just like similar to AR. Okay. So similarly, you can say BR is equal to 2 by T integral 0 to T F of T. Instead of sin R omega T, we have cos R omega T dt. Okay. So in this way, we can calculate the Fourier coefficients. Once the Fourier coefficients are known, the Fourier series is exactly known. Okay, f of t is equal to a0 plus summation over n from 1 to infinity an sin n omega t, sum over n from 1 to infinity bn cos n omega t. So only unknown quantities are a0, an, and bn. And we have now obtained a method to calculate these coefficients, Fourier coefficients. Okay, now let us apply this idea of Fourier's theorem on Fourier series to, okay, so what we have expressed in Fourier theorem is that any periodic function can be expressed as a linear combination of sine functions and cos functions, right? Any periodic function can be expressed as a linear combination like this. So conversely, we can say if you have a linear combination of sine functions and cos functions, by choosing properly sine functions and cos functions are of specific frequencies, we can construct any periodic function. Okay, so let's try to express a periodic function in terms of this simple harmonic functions. Consider an example. So consider a square wave here. This is, as we have earlier considered, this is a finite function. Okay, its values remain finite at any point. It is single valued at any time t. You have only one value for f of t, and it's a periodic function. There is a periodicity, it regularly repeats. So it has a period capital T. So between 0, you can see that between 0 and t by 2, its value is a. Between t by 2 and t, its value is 0. And then again, it is t by 2, a, then 3. Okay, then 3 t by 2, 3 t by 2 to okay, 3t by 2 to 2t, its value is again 0, and this pattern is repeated. Okay. And this is, you can express in algebraic form, you can express it like this. Okay, the value between 0 and t by 2 is a here, and between t by 2 to t, its value is 0. Okay. Let us try to express this function as a Fourier series. Okay, so the task is, we know the Fourier series, the form is like this. F of t is equal to a0 plus sum over n an sine n omega t plus sum over n bn cos n omega t. Okay, so let us evaluate this each term. We need to find out what is a0, what is ar, and what is br. So what is this a0? A0, the value is 1 by t, it's average of the function, 0 to t, f of t, dt, right? Now this is equal to, the period of the function is also capital T. When you integrate this function from 0 to t, only from 0 to t by 2, the function is non-zero, a. From t by 2 to t, the function is, see here the function is 0. So the only contribution comes from 0 to t by 2. So let us integrate from 0 to t by 2. And what is the value of the function here? A. Some constant value between 0 and t by 2. See here. Between 0 and t by 2, its value is A. So you just put A here, dt. Okay. You can take A outside. A is a constant. So integral of dt is t. The upper limit gives t by 2. So what you get is a by 2, okay, that is a0. Now what about ar? Any arbitrary, any general term in the second set, that is an sine n omega t. So what is the expression for ar? Ar is 2 by t integral 0 to t f of t sine r omega t dt. Okay, so this is equal to 2 by t. This is the general definition of AR, a general way of calculating. Here, we don't have to calculate, we need to calculate only from 0 to t by 2. So let us put that here, 0 to t by 2. F of t, the value of f of t is a sine r omega t dt. Okay. So that's equal to 2 by t a. What is the integral of sine r omega t? Minus cos r omega t divided by r omega 0 to t by 2. Okay. Okay, we can take constant terms outside. So minus 2 by t a by r omega. When you put the upper limit, what you have is omega into t by 2 is 2 pi. So we have omega into t by 2 is 2 pi by 2. So we have pi. So cos r pi is 1. Minus, when you put t equals 0, cos 0 is 1. Okay, that is 2 by t a by r omega 1 minus cos r pi. Let's consider two types of solutions. For r is equal to 1, 3, 5, etc. Odd values of r. For this, what is the value of ar? For odd values of r, 1, 3, 5, etc., cos r pi, for example, cos pi minus 1, cos 3 pi is minus 1. Similarly, cos 5 pi is minus 1. So, we have minus 1 here. And 1 minus minus 1 will be 1 plus 1. So, we have 2. And this 2 can be multiplied with this 2 here. So what you have is what you have is 4 by t a by r omega. This you can further simplify. In the denominator, t into omega, capital T into omega is 2 pi. So 1, 2 will cancel. So we get 2a divided by r pi. Okay, for different values of r, for odd values of r, 1, 3, 5, etc. ar is equal to 2a by r pi. what about the even values? So for r is equal to 2, 4, 6, etc. even values, what is ar? For even values, for example, cos 2 pi, here in this expression, what happens when r is equal to 2? Cos 2 pi is 1, 1 minus 1 is 0. Similarly, cos 4 pi, cos 6 pi, etc. are all 1. 1 minus 1 is 0. So, ar values are 0. Okay. For even r, for odd r, ar values are given. Okay. That's all about AR, and then similarly calculate BR. Okay, so what is the expression for BR? BR is equal to 2 by T 0 to T F of T cos n omega T dt. Okay. So that's equal to 2 by t integral 0 to t by 2. Okay, t by 2 to t f of t is 0. So here f of 0 to t by 2 f of t is a, and we have cos, here it is r. Okay, cos r omega t dt. So that is 2a by t. Again, what is integral of cos r omega t? Sin r omega t divided by r omega limits from 0 to t by 2. So when you put t, small t equal to capital T by 2, omega into t is 2 pi, 2 pi by 2 is pi. So sin r pi minus sin 0. Sin 0 is 0. Sin r pi is also 0. Any value of r we get 0 for sin r pi. Okay, for if it is for any integer value of r, whether it is even or odd, this will be 0. So what you get is br equal to 0 for any value of r. Okay. Now we can try to write down the entire series. So what is the approximation for this series that we have obtained? Okay, so what is the approximation? We have obtained a zero, we have obtained a value for AR. So how do you write this? We can write f of t is equal to a zero is a by 2, I think. Let's see. A zero is equal to a by 2. Then what is AR? AR is 2a by r pi, right? So we can write this as this is for 1, 3, 5, etc. Right? So we can say sum over r from 1, 3, 5, etc. odd values. Right? So for r equal to 1, 3, 5, etc., what is the coefficient? 2a by r pi. So we can write this as 2a by r pi sine r omega t, right? And br part is 0. There is no br for any value of r. Okay, let us further expand this. So we can write this as f of t is equal to a by 2 plus we can take 2a by pi outside. Okay, then put r equal to 1, we have sine omega t. R equal to 3, there is a 1 by r term here, so we have 1 by 3 sine 3 omega t. Okay, then put r equal to 5. Okay, see that there is a 1 by r here. We have taken 2 by pi out, 2a by pi outside, but 1 by r will be there. Okay, in the first term it is 1 by 1 sine 1 omega t. In the second term, 1 by 3 sine 3 omega t. So in the third term, we have 1 by 5 sine 5 omega t, etc. So this is the expansion of this function, this square wave function, in terms of simple harmonic terms. This is the Fourier series for that function. Okay. Now we can see that when you add these terms together, we get an approximate form of the square wave. When you add more and more terms, it becomes more and more a square wave. Okay. Let us try to see this, visualize this using a graphing software. Okay, so I hope you understand how we can apply Fourier's theorem and different periodic waves, how we can decompose into a series of components, a series of simple harmonic components. Okay, it is this series and it is called Fourier series. Okay, f of t is equal to a zero plus sum over n from 1 to infinity an sin n omega t, sum over n from 1 to infinity bn cos n omega t. Depending upon the nature of the periodic function, sometimes sine terms will be absent, sometimes cosine terms will be absent. We have seen that in the case of square wave, cosine terms are not there. Okay, so that depends upon how the function is defined and how we it's defined along different time intervals. Okay, so we have also seen how this can be applied for a square wave. Okay, now let us come back to this final formula for a square wave and see if we can reproduce the square wave by adding these terms. Okay, see if we add the terms on the right side, do we get the square wave? Let us see. Okay, now we are going to use a graphing calculator. Okay. There are different graphing calculators available in the internet. One is this one, Desmos, then another is GeoGebra. Okay, let me use this one. If you type the function on the left panel, the graph of this function will be obtained on the right side. This is a good device to study the variation of different functions. Okay, you can do it on your own. So in the previous class we have seen that when you add two simple harmonic functions of slightly different frequencies, you get a sort of beats, right? You get a resultant wave whose amplitude slowly varies, right? Then we talked about the phase speed of this resultant, phase velocity of this resultant wave. Also, what is the group velocity that we have discussed. Let us see this how this resultant wave emerges. Okay. So here, in the previous class, we considered a function y1 equal to sin k1 x minus omega 1 t, y2 equal to sin k2 x minus omega 2 t, like that. So here, I am assuming that time is zero. Okay. In other words, I am considering these functions at the initial time. So what you get is not a traveling wave but a standing wave. So I am considering two such standing waves. There is no time dependence. Okay. So consider a function like sin x. Let's consider. This is the plot of sin x. So let me slightly increase the amplitude, let us say 5 sin x. Okay, so the amplitude has increased. So this is one function. So here k is equal to 1. This is like a sin kx. As I told you, this minus omega t part is not there. So this is a standing wave. It varies spatially with x, but there is no time dependence. Okay, so here k1 is equal to let us say 1. So remember that we considered when we discussed the group velocity and phase velocity, we considered y1 equal to a sin k1 x minus omega 1 t. If you remove that time dependent part, or if you put t equal to 0, you get a sin k1 x. So this is the same structure. Amplitude a is 5, k1 is 1. Okay. Let us consider another function. Amplitude is 5, again same amplitude. Consider another sine function of slightly different frequency, wave number 1.1x. Okay. So the color code is given here. Red one is having k1 equal to 1. Blue one is having k2 equal to 1.1. So the wave number of the red wave is k1 equal to 1. Wave number of the blue wave is blue sine wave is k2 equal to 1.1. Okay, so now let us see what is the nature of the resultant wave when you add these two together. So we have 5 sin x, okay, plus 5 sin 1.1 x. okay, this is the resultant wave. Green one is the resultant wave. Okay, so let us see this. Yeah. Now you can see that this at some points this resultant wave, green one is the resultant wave. The amplitude of the green wave is very high compared to the individual waves. The two individual waves, red and blue, their amplitude is constant, right? But this green wave, see, its amplitude increases, it's maximum here, then amplitude decreases, and at this point the amplitude goes to zero. Why it is going to zero, or why it decreases? Because see, the individual waves, red and blue waves, even though their amplitudes are the same, constant amplitude, but their wavelengths are slightly different, or wave numbers are slightly different. So when their resultant amplitude is progressively added, that means consider the principle of superposition. Okay, when two or more waves simultaneously pass through a region, the resultant displacement at any point is the sum of the vector sum of the individual displacements, right? So here what happens is, for example, at this point, the individual displacements is somewhat less. So compared to this here. Here the two individual displacements y1 and y2 are added together, two crusts are there, maximum displacements are there. So resultant wave also has a very high displacement, but then it decreases. The because at any at this point the red wave as well as blue wave has a slightly lower displacement, so the resultant displacement decreases. And here, for example, when you come here, red wave, both red wave and blue wave have zero displacement. So the resultant wave also has zero displacement. So the amplitude decreases, becomes minimum, and then it increases. Okay, if you move back, you can see that the resultant wave like this. In order to see the resultant wave more clearly, let me switch off this individual waves. So you see only the resultant wave. See this? We have seen this type of behavior. I have drawn it in the class on phase velocity and group velocity. Okay, this type of a wave is called a wave packet. Why? Because it contains, here in this particular example, it contains two individual waves, two simple harmonic waves. It's a combination, a packet, or a group of two simple harmonic waves. Okay, so you can see that there is a rapidly oscillating part in this wave. And if you look at the envelope, overall amplitude, see, it slowly becomes maximum and then decreases minimum. And then again it increases like that. Okay. So the amplitude of the resultant wave as a whole, it slowly varies. Okay, so there is a slowly varying part. And that we know that the velocity of this rapidly varying part is the phase velocity, which is omega average by k average. Velocity of the slowly varying part is called group velocity. Why is it called group velocity? Because this wave contains two simple harmonic waves. Okay. So it's called a group velocity, and it's delta omega by delta k. If you add more and more waves with slightly different k values, now the difference is 0.1. I can reduce it further. I can add more terms and reduce the difference between k1, k2, k3 further. Then in the limiting case, when delta k tends to 0 and delta omega also tends to 0, we get delta omega or d omega by dk. And remember that in order to talk about the speed, we have to add the time dependent part, that kx minus omega 1t, k2x minus omega 2t, that part should also be there. Here we have considered only the spatial dependence part, but you can see that what is the behavior when two such waves superpose. Okay. Okay, so here we have this time dependent function. F of t is a time dependent function with the angular frequency omega, and each component, simple harmonic component, has the angular frequency integral multiple of omega, 3 omega, 5 omega, etc. Integral multiple of the angular frequency of the original function. Now suppose we, instead of this time domain function, we call it time domain function or time dependent function. Let us say the function depends on the spatial variable x. Okay, instead of time dependence, let us assume that this f is a function of x. Then instead of omega t here, you will be having kx, because this simple harmonic term, if you are talking about a traveling wave, your simple harmonic terms are sine kx minus omega t. That's a simple harmonic traveling wave, sine kx minus omega t or cos kx minus omega t. So this omega t is the time dependent part, kx is the space dependence part. In the phase angle, kx part is the space dependent part of the phase angle, omega t is the time dependent part of the phase angle. So when you decompose a time dependent function into Fourier series, each term will be sine omega t, sine 2 omega t, 3 omega t, etc. It so happens that in this particular example, we have only odd functions, odd multiples of omega, and cosine terms are absent here. But in general, there will be sine omega t, sine 2 omega t, sine 3 omega t, similarly cos omega t, cos 2 omega t, cos 3 omega t, etc. But if we talk about a function which depends on the position x, then the sine and cosine terms will be sine kx, the phase angle will be kx, sine 2 kx, sine 3 kx, etc. Okay, so let me try to reconstruct this function in terms of x. Okay, sine kx, sine 3 kx, etc. So that's what I'm going to do. Instead of t, let's assume that instead of the variable t, we are using x. then omega, instead of omega I am using k, that's all. Okay, so instead of this omega t phase angle, I am using the phase angle kx. Let us say a is equal to some 5. There is a constant term a in the Fourier series, right? And I am fixing k as 1. Okay. And say our function is, what is that, a by 2 plus 2a by pi, right? So we can take pi from here, 2a by pi. Okay, first term will be a by 2 plus 2a by pi, so sine omega t. Instead of sine omega t, I am using sine kx. Okay. So that is the first term. Second term is 1 by 3 sine 3kx. Third term is 1 by 5 sine 5kx. Okay, so let us consider these three terms. So this is what we have plotted: a by 2 plus 2a by pi sin kx, 1 by 3 sin 3kx, 1 by 5 sin kx. I have put a as 5 and k as 1. Okay, see, this is what we have obtained. This is approximately a square wave, right? It's approximately a square wave. If we add more and more terms, next term will be 1 by 7 sine 7kx. Next will be 1 by 9 sine 9kx. So if we add more and more terms, it will be more and more close, closer and closer to the square wave. So in this way, by adding a large number of simple harmonic terms, we can construct a periodic function. See, we have been talking about a time-dependent function expressed in Fourier series like this. Some a0 plus some sine term plus some cos term. So let me say, consider only the sine term. So it is like this: summation over 1 from n from 1 to infinity an sine n omega t. This is how we wrote it. Now suppose we rewrite this. So this contains integral multiples of omega, and summation is over those integers, right? So in this expression, this amplitude a varies with this each integer term, right? As n increases, an varies, amplitude varies, it either increases or decreases. And also this frequency becomes integral multiples, 1 omega, 2 omega, 3 omega, etc. So this is a summation over n. I can also write this as a summation over omega. Okay, and I can assume that instead of a varying with n, amplitude varying with n, amplitude varies with omega. So this term I can rewrite as summation over omega from 1 to infinity, amplitude varies with omega, and here it is sine omega t. Okay, so omega varies. Here also, in this expression also, omega is varying. When n changes, angular frequency changes, 1 omega, 2 omega, 3 omega, etc. Amplitude also changes with n, and here in this expression the idea is the same. Amplitude, instead of capital A, I am using small a, that's all. Amplitude varies with omega, and as angular frequency changes, it becomes integral multiples, amplitude also changes with omega, and here omega will change. Okay, that is the idea. So this Fourier series you can either express like this or express like this. This is not the complete series. I have considered only the sine terms. Similarly, there will be cosine terms. Okay, so let us consider the sine part. So this is a Fourier series. If we rewrite this in terms of let us say x, okay, then this I can write this as f of x equals summation over, instead of omega t, the phase angle will be now kx. So summation will be over k, summation over k from 1 to infinity a of k sine kx. So if we consider the sine terms in the Fourier series, it will be like this. So let me first put this amplitude a of k as 1. Okay, we get a straight line like this. Okay, let us switch it off. Now consider a Fourier series using sine functions. Okay, so f1 of x equals, okay, we have to use the summation symbol. We can get it from here. Click on the keyboard, go to the functions, then in the miscellaneous section we have this symbol summation. I am going to sum over k values. Okay, so k from 1 to 10, consider 10 terms, a of k, that is the amplitude. We have fixed the amplitude as 1, but let's consider this a of k sine kx. This is the plot. So we get a continuous wave, an infinite wave, a periodic wave, okay, with some weird shape. So when you add the 10 terms, we get like this, with some shape. Okay, now let us consider, suppose I add, so here what is the difference between each k number, each wave number? 1, k varies from 1 to 10 integer values. So in the first term we have a of k is always 1. The first term is sine x, second term will be sine 2x, then sine 3x, sine 4x, etc. Okay, this is same as putting k equal to 1 and vary n, sine n kx, and then put n equal to 1, n equal to 2, n equal to 3, etc. So instead of summing over n, I am just summing over k. So here k is 1, next is k is 2, so sine 1x, sine 2x, plus sine 3x, etc., plus sine 10x. If you add 10 terms with all with amplitude 1, you get like this. So here the difference between wave number values, k values, is 1. Now suppose I reduce this difference, if I, between 1 and 10, suppose I add more and more k values, suppose after 1 I put 1.001, then 1.002, etc. So in this way, if we reduce the difference between subsequent k values, delta k tends to 0, then the summation goes to integration. Instead of summation, we have an integral. Such an integral is called a Fourier integral. Okay. So Fourier integral also called we can also call it Fourier transform. So let us rewrite this function as a Fourier integral, then let us see what happens. So f2x, let me use another symbol for this. Instead of summation, let me use integration. Again, go to functions, you have integral here, 1 to 10. Again, the amplitude a of k sine kx dk. Okay, let us see what happens. Yeah, you get something like this. Let us see, you can see that this is a single pulse, it's not periodically changing. Okay, again you go to switch it off and it takes some time. Consider again this. Here, Fourier series, you add just 10 sine terms, 10 sine functions, you get this. Of equal amplitude, you get this. You get a periodic function. Okay. But here, you add infinite number of sine terms. There are infinite number of sine terms between 1 and 10. The difference between subsequent k values in each sine kx is very negligibly small. Okay, so if you add a large number of sine functions, each of amplitude 1, then you, instead of a periodic function, you get an aperiodic function. Aperiodic means it's not repeating. See, it's not repeating, it's a single pulse. So in order to create this is called a wave pulse. It's not a traveling wave here in this plot. It's a standing wave, but a wave pulse can be produced by a Fourier integral. Okay, so here we have in f1x we have a Fourier series, but when you reduce the number of the difference in k values between, or difference in omega values, if we are talking in time domain, sine omega t terms. So either the difference in k values or difference in omega values, if you reduce, then it goes to tends to zero, then the summation becomes integration. This is called a Fourier integral or Fourier transform. And this one, this integral f2x, this will produce a wave pulse. So a wave pulse can be produced by a Fourier integral. Okay, then we can change this amplitude. Suppose instead of 1, let me take 1 by k. Let us see what happens to Fourier series. The series will be of this structure, a so-called, some sort of a sawtooth wave. What about this one, Fourier integral? In the integration will take some time. Yeah, you get a pulse again of see, of this type of a shape. It's a pulse, it's not repeating, it's not repeating. Okay, you get a pulse like this. So this is called a wave pulse. So in this way you can change the amplitude in any different ways. If it is a Fourier series, we get a periodic function. So a periodic function can be constructed from a Fourier series. A wave pulse, a periodic wave, can be constructed from a Fourier series. A wave pulse which is not getting repeated, this can be constructed from a Fourier integral.